I'm Judy Gay, Vice President for Academic Affairs at Community College of Philadelphia. Today, it is my pleasure to have a conversation with Dr. Olga Dugan. Dr. Dugan is Assistant Professor of English, teaching literature and composition in both the English department and the honors curriculum at Community College of Philadelphia. She's a native Philadelphian who graduated from the High School for Creative and Performing Arts and also from our local university, Temple University, with her bachelor's degree. She received her master's degree and her doctorate from the University of Rochester. She's published scholarly papers in literature and in writing pedagogy, and she has award-winning poems published in literary magazines. But today, the focus of our conversation is on the fact that Dr. Dugan is the 2008 recipient of the Lindbeck Distinguished Teaching Award. For those of you who don't know, the Lindbeck Award is given in this region, New Jersey, Maryland, Delaware, which actually is the region that used to be serviced by the Abbott Dairies. The Christian R. and Mary F. Lindbeck Foundation years ago recognized the importance of recognizing excellence in teaching and created this award for colleges and universities to provide each year to one distinguished teacher. In 2008, Dr. Dugan was the recipient. Welcome, Dr. Dugan.
Thank you, Judy.
I hope it's okay to call you Olga.
That's perfectly fine. Great.
So when you found out that you were the recipient, it's always a surprise, and at Community College of Philadelphia, the award is given during graduation. So I'm assuming that you were elated to find out that you were the recipient.
Oh, yes.
And then you find out later on, perhaps, that the recipient at Community College of Philadelphia is then required to give a lecture to the college community on a topic of his or her choice, but related in some way to teaching. Yes. So when you hear, go from elation to the responsibility of talking to the college community, how did that make you feel?
Well, probably the way I feel at the moment. there was some trepidation, of course, because the old adage is that it's easy to speak of what one does in front of a bunch of strangers, but when you speak in front of people you know, people you care about, you respect, it's a completely different story. And so there was a lot of nervousness, a lot of fear. What will people think? Will they agree? These are people I work with every day. And then I realized, wait a minute, these are the people who gave me the award in the first place, mm-hmm. the award in the first place. And I decided, as Teresa Tsai said in her fourth Lindbeck lecture, this is a chance to get on a soapbox and talk about what I love and what I'm passionate about. And so it took me a great deal of time, Judy, to just, well, the whole 10 months, to just go back to why I began teaching in the first place. What do I take into a classroom with me when I walk in? Who am I talking to when I go into the classroom, or whom am I talking to when I go into a classroom? What have I read that's helped me develop myself as a teacher? And who are my mentors? Mm. So much to order, to put into order. But I managed to do it because finally I decided this is not so much of a challenge as it is a privilege to be able to talk about teaching to other people, especially my students, and give them a sense of the fact that I really do care about and respect them.
So that time between receiving the award in May and doing a presentation during the spring semester gave you a chance for reflection.
Oh my goodness,
yes. It wasn't as much agonizing over it as really coming to the idea that it is an opportunity to have a conversation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And also, too, the gift, the idea that it's, I asked Vince Castro-Nuovo, another Lindbeck winner.
Winner. Right.
In the hallway, I think this was sometime in December, I said, oh my God, Vince, all I can come up with is that this is a gift. How do you talk about a gift? And he said, Olga, start with that line.
Oh.
And that was an amazing thing to say, because once he did, I felt it was okay now to talk about the gift, and the gift being what I've learned from my students here. You hear people say that all the time, but do many people actually explain what that really means? And so I decided, let's talk about that.
And the title of your presentation, and the other thing I should mention, at Community College of Philadelphia, once the presentation is over, then you also get to create a document.
Yes.
That catalogs basically what your presentation is. So you get to take it from the spoken format into a written format. And I have my much dog-eared copy of the draft of your paper. But your presentation was called Turning Pedagogy Inside Out, Teaching Students as Thinkers and Theorists. Tell me a little bit about the title. What were you trying to convey there?
Well, I'm laughing because Dr. Curtis, I believe, mentioned the title at the beginning of the year. And a few of my colleagues heard it, and they were wondering, what in the world does turning pedagogy inside out mean? And I didn't feel badly about that, because, but here's what it means. The title itself signals for me a few things. Number one, what I consider to be a problem that all serious faculty on all levels of higher education have to deal with. Number two, it signals what I consider to be an understanding about what students need, an understanding about the needs students generate through their own written, oral, and signed expression. Mm. And I consider that understanding to be a way of combating the problem. I'm not quite sure about solving it, but certainly combating it. Should I say a little
bit? And say a little bit about what the problem is, yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The problem, Judy, is that pedagogy inside is a matter of teaching principles contingent on presumptions about what students need. And to practice such principles would be a matter of going into a classroom and teaching to the demands of those needs. And if you do something like that, you don't really make a connection to the students at all. So what happens is you don't consider students as thinkers. You don't consider the possibility that they have a sense of how the world is working. None of that has anything to do with the way that you are relating to your material or the way you're presenting that material. And that's a problem.
Almost as though if you're inside the academy, inside the ivory tower, there's a language, there are expectations that are not necessarily connected in a direct way to the lives of students. And if you're too much inside and stay inside, that we can't have that relationship or conversation with students in a way that's helpful to them, is that?
That's right. Teaching becomes a matter of induction, mm-hmm. rather than actually connecting to the students and initiating them into the academic culture from on a foundation that the students help to generate in the first place.
Okay.
And that's a grave problem. Because what usually results would be students who either completely give up or they try to participate in activities that have been generated without any understanding of who they are or what they're capable of doing. And those students are often the word would be forced into a kind of self-reductionism, mm-hmm. That shows up their inadequacies and so forth and on. It thrusts inadequacies on them and then suggests that it's some kind of deficiency on their part, that they're not meeting the requirements of this kind of world.
A lot of times there's an expectation on the part of an institution that you'll have your syllabus ready the first day. You'll give the syllabus out. So before you even know anything about who the students are in the classroom, we're coming in from the inside and saying, this is what will happen. It almost doesn't matter who the audience is.
I see where you're coming from. And mm-hmm. that's I'm glad you brought it up too, because a lot of people would think turning pedagogy inside out means, then holistic teaching. We just walk in and you listen to what the students say and how they feel, and you generate your syllabus from there. No, actually, to initiate someone into membership suggests that you're going to have a syllabus ready, that you know where point B is,
right. Okay,
and you want to get your students there. Turning pedagogy inside out has everything to do with finding out where the students are. Where's point A? And how might you use what the students bring with them to help guide how you're going to use that syllabus to get them to point B? And you know, so that they can experience and even enjoy membership in the academic culture that you're offering to them, that you're offering access.
So that is a unique approach, more of the guide and still understanding what is required in the discipline. You're the more knowledgeable person, navigator, I guess, of the discipline, but it's really figuring out where are they now, and as you're saying, point A to connect to point B. So for the lecture, you did something that was different. We've been doing these distinguished lectures. This was the seventh one. And you did something that was different from what everyone else has done, which was essentially to, I don't want to say use us as guinea pigs, but you made us part of what you called a rhetorical community. In that, and let me just say a few words since I was there. Came into the room and everybody was given a bookmark. And on the bookmark was a poem that you had written. And we also got a set of questions that we were going to, sets of questions that we were going to be using later on. So already, you were going to put us to work. But I think maybe for the audience to get some perspective on what we heard and how we participated in the event, perhaps you could read the poem that we all had a chance to read, which was your work called Raising Cain.
Right? Okay, so. I'd be happy to. Thank you. Let's see, I have it with me. Oh. Right here.
Just happened to have it with you.
Yes. I have to remove my glasses for this. Raising Cain. Cain roams the world without a rest. The street hood strolled into my classroom to have his turn at making palimpsest of the world's first fratricide's doom. He just strolls into my classroom to spill some brother's blood, to write over the first fratricide's doom, clueless of a choice to stem this flood. No, he'll spill some brother's blood, scouring each row as he takes a seat, clueless of a choice to stem this flood. He turns that imperative stare on me, demands an answer. Where is he? Do you belong here? Could not help but ask. He covers his surprise, his tongue in cheek. Hell yeah, I belong in your class. Do you belong here? Could not help but ask. For behind the virulence, I see a young man who, yes, for a moment, belonged in my class. The light of ancient wisdoms had chiseled their plans and features of a heritage not given to chance, but to creative power and virility. There in his brow, wisdom chiseled its plan for a Homer's or a griot's ability. But over creative power, virility, Cain rose up in a frowning forehead, a haughty chin. Over Homer's ability, over the griot's grace, he groused instead, "What you looking at?" Cain's mark was on his head. He's my brother, but not for me to keep. Over wisdom's grace, he chose hate instead. You leave now, or I call security. My voice weeps. He rises up and flees. The door clicks thunder behind him. Soon after, he'd put bullets in his target's spleen on the word of a slighted girlfriend. I watched police slam car doors behind them, the coroner cover vacant eyes, miss a shoe, and wondered if a slighted friend might someday serve Cain his fair due. Later, I recall vacant eyes, the shoe, as I wield my chalk to make palimpsest, to write over the first efforts to help folks choose to raise Cain and give our world a rest.
So why that poem for this audience?
I wrote the poem based on an actual event that occurred in 2005, mm-hmm. when I was teaching 101 here at mm-hmm. the college. And I explained to the audience that there was no death involved. But I wrote the poem because I remember how I felt as a teacher looking at, actually it was three young men, looking at three young men walk into my classroom and thinking right away that they were students who just had not shown up. Mm-hmm. And when I realized, obviously, after they attacked one of my students after class, so much went through my mind. I was helpless in that classroom. What if they had opened fire against my students? Mm-hmm. It was so much, Judy. But what stood out, why this poem, was my attitude. I really thought of those young men as possible students, somebody, people who had value, who could be doing something with their lives. And I wanted to write about that. Why for the Lindbeck lecture? Mm-hmm. I thought the poem was appropriate because it's actually an illustration of the type of understanding I'm trying to talk about in terms of what does it mean to understand what your students need relative to what your students have actually said about their needs in terms of their written expression and so forth and on. To understand means that you have to have a certain type of attitude first, and the poem illustrates again that attitude. You give people the benefit of the doubt first. Mm-hmm. So I remember at the lecture, one of my colleagues raised her hand and she said, "But this woman, this teacher, called the young man a street hood." And I called attention to the fact that a pantoum works in anti-narrative time, meaning that it's constantly calling attention to the past so that the present makes sense. So what you get is the teacher's attitude is not that he's a street hood first. Her attitude is that he has the ability, well, he has the features of a person who could be a Homer or a griot, mm-hmm. okay? And then events happen for that convince her that he's wasted his life or is wasting his life.
This was an unusual situation that happened to you.
Oh, absolutely.
But
unusual.
You turned it into a poem that tried to bring some understanding to what had happened in that event and then connected it to something that your audience might be able to understand. I mean, we live in a time when we know violence happens. And it can happen any place at any time. I think people have come to feel that way. But how do you always approach a situation, as you're saying, do you start out giving people the benefit of the doubt and then let events unfold and then start to make some decisions or think about it differently based on that?
It's the only way to teach mm-hmm. for me. You mentioned being guinea pigs.
Right.
Well, I was doing the same thing with the audience. I walked into that room, yes, very nervous, but at the same time, I understood that I was about to address an audience of intelligent people. What I thought to myself, what did they bring? I know what I've brought. I brought my lecture. but what did my audience bring with them? And how do I find a way to connect to them so that they can give to me what it is they brought, so that I can give to them what I have in such a way that it connects to what they've brought.
So it's important to hear, try to figure out where point A was in the audience.
Absolutely.
Okay. So what you did next was to give us on the yellow sheet three sets of questions. And I'm not going to read the questions now, but could you talk a little bit about your thinking about the kinds of differences between those sets of questions and how you were trying to connect that to, and force us to approach the poem from different points of view, perhaps?
Actually, the sets of questions would create situations for certain events to happen. We just mentioned you walk in and with a certain type of attitude, and you create situations so that the audience can begin to perform, and events occur and things happen the way they happen in order to get people to point B. Mm-hmm. So here's how that worked. The certain situations. Set one was focused, or was a matter of questions focused on an affective response to the poem. And what that actually means is, for most students, when I say students, I'm not talking about certain ages or whatever. I just mean people who are confronted with a text. Some people feel very comfortable looking at what's on the page. Mm-hmm. And they would rather try to run something called an expressive line on what they see. That's perfectly fine. A lot of students are told that that's not a good place to be. It's absolutely a good place to be. It's where everybody needs to start. And so a certain type of event happens. Here's the event, which I really love because my students are always surprised when I say it. You're not just looking at what's on the page. You're putting a spin on what's on the page.
Right.
And that spin is coming from somewhere. I haven't said anything to you, so it has to be coming from you. And usually it's a lived experience, or several, that is actually determining what the student is finding familiar and not familiar in the text. And so they'll run out certain stories about what they see. Set two is for the analytical mind. And I knew that I was going to run into creative writing professors and the scientists in the room. And so set two focuses on ways of framing what it is you see on the page. So you have a lot of students who wish to jump right to an interpretation, but they have to slow down and be taught how to recognize perception, different types of established perceptions that they could then use to actually define the spin they've put on a text. Set three.
That's the set my partner and I chose. So what does that tell you about me?
An administrator who is orderly and structured.
Right.
Set three, I think, would be my favorite set. It's for what I call the honest student, not meaning that the first or second are not, but the student who says, I'm confused, and what, you know, that student, either the student wants to get away with saying I'm confused and then you don't have to do work, or mostly I'm confused and that confirms what I've been told for a very long time, that I'm not capable of doing this work. Or if they haven't been told, it's been somehow shown.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I love it when people choose questions like set three. Set three, again, was something like, you know, based on your own experience as a student, could you describe the teacher's attitude towards the
right.
the student in the poem? again, I want students to know that their confusion is actually a spin that they're putting on the text in front of them. And we can use that confusion as a point A. You unpack it, because usually confusion is a matter of just simply not knowing why I'm looking at this thing the way I'm looking at it, okay? If we could get to the baseline of that confusion, we can actually begin to talk about the possibility of defining the confusion as perhaps some kind of debate. Usually it's a debate about what a student thinks, or I'll put it this way. It's a debate about what the student knows versus what the student is being confronted with. So one person in the audience, and I remember this, one person in the audience said, well, how can this be a poem? It sounds more like a story. So what I picked up from that was, this person has a problem with mixing genres. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's a real debate, literary debate. And the person doesn't even know that he or she is actually participating in that debate.
They've moved inside.
That's right. Right. They're already inside. Right. And then it's my job then as mentor. And it's really funny because a mentor is a servant. And mm-hmm. I think people never think of it that way. But you're serving somebody when you're mentoring mm-hmm. that person. And I tell them, here's the debate you're working with. Read these folks. See where do you stand. And I think what the student really loves about number three, and what happens in my classroom anyway, is that they're not, the far side of this is not a matter of aligning oneself necessarily with any side, mm-hmm. because confusion itself can be a viable position.
In the audience, your mother was there, your yes. sister was there, you had family members, you had friends, and you talk a lot about the influence that family has had on your journey to becoming a teacher, and perhaps even to becoming a distinguished teacher. Could you talk a little bit about those influences, those early influences on you, yes. and how it has kind of shaped your thoughts about teaching?
Gladly. I'm always glad to do that. I would begin, as I do in my essay, with my grandmother, who, and I'll be pretty brief about this mm-hmm. because these are really long stories. So what my grandmother taught me, believe it or not, was literary criticism at 3 years old. Mm. But of course, I didn't know that. She would choose a chapter from the Bible, or sometimes have me choose one. And she'd say, read this, and then tell me, what do you think? What do you think about what you see? And she often said, what you see on the page. And of course, I thought, okay, well, this is a game, and so I did. I fell in love with words right then. I also became extremely curious about why I thought about what I was reading and the way I thought about it. And maybe mm-hmm. that's because of the nature of what I was reading, since it was spiritual. Mm-hmm. I might have been thinking in terms of my relationship with God. I don't know. But I do know that conversations with my grandmother led to looking at literature, whether it was the Bible or some other story, as a kind of metaphor, a picture of the world that I was living in. And it gave me some kind of baseline or frame for thinking about how I connected to this world. So at a very, very young age, I learned to see a certain type of value in stories and in words themselves. My next teacher would be my mother. And again, it amazes me now that I'm older and I have nieces and nephews of my own who want to read to me every day when I come home from work. My mother had two jobs and listened to me whenever, and it was usually every day, Judy, that I had something I wanted to read to her. what I remember most about those sessions with her, again, was learning about not only that I loved words, but I became very interested in how they work together. How you can actually forge a language, a voice, through these living things called words. Mm. And I began with Mom reading literature. Mom was a big Shakespeare fan, and my book shelf, and I want to give people the understanding that we're not talking about a rich person's house. Mm. I live in a row house, and my parents were working class people, but they loved reading and they believed in education. And so Mom had just shelves and shelves of books. For example, I saw Dr. Faustus on television with Richard Burton and Elizabeth mm-hmm. Taylor. I wanted to read it. I pulled it down off the shelf. Mm-hmm. And Mom and I read Christopher Marlowe. And it was, I think I was seven then.
Mm, wow.
I realized that's it. I want to absorb as many of these stories as I possibly can, because what I learned, Judy, was that as I absorbed, I learned a language. Or maybe I should put it this way. As I absorbed, I developed my own language, mm-hmm. my own voice. And I was able to articulate, and it just fascinated me. And then I wanted to teach it. I wanted everybody to know what it was like. And school became not just a place I had to go to, it became a safe haven, a place where I felt that I was actually developing into a real person. And that's never left me. But yes, those are my
early memories. That's interesting, because my mother was the same way. She had the complete collection of Shakespeare. She had all of the classics. And she also, she read some contemporary literature at that time, but I had a lot of books. Again, small row house. We lived over a store, actually, but our house was full of books, and started reading at an early age, and was captivated by that. So it's interesting, those early influences, that early exposure to reading and words and yes. stories yes. can be such a powerful influence on somebody as they move through the educational experience. So
that's right.
Very interesting, we have that connection in common. You also mentioned, and you mentioned earlier, mentors. And I know you've referred in the past to some critical mentors in terms of shaping your philosophy about teaching. So are there some people in particular who had an influence on your ideas that led you to this thinking about turning pedagogy inside out?
Absolutely. I spend a lot of time in the essay talking about David Bleich. Mm. It was, I believe, 1987 through 1989 that I worked very closely with David Bleich at the University of Rochester. Mm-hmm. And while David and I had our differences, and we probably still do, he would laugh at that at the moment. David introduced me to three books, again, that I mentioned in the essay. And the books made themselves seem disparate. You know, they're talking about completely different things. But when you look at them in the context of student needs, they all seem to be talking actually about the same thing. And what I mean by that is the books are Gerald Graff's Professing Literature.
Yes, I know that one.
Trent T. Menha's Woman, Native, Other. And finally, David's own work. At the time, it wasn't, the book is Know and Tell. But at that time, he was putting together articles to arrange into mm-hmm. the book. What David pointed out, what I call warnings, David warned new upcoming faculty of a type of view on student writing that neglects, well, first of all, he calls it hygiene. He says, you know, these is a view that believes that writing itself is a technical enterprise. It's all skill. Mm-hmm. While you're at the same time, you're neglecting the fact that there is a relationship between language and society, and that each of our students walk in the classroom with some aspect of that, of knowing about that connection between language and society. Mm-hmm. In other words, they have some understanding of how writing works, and they have some understanding of how to make sense of how writing works. So he says, that's being neglected by people who focus only on skill. Mm-hmm. That's one problem. And I'm sorry. The outcome of that is the ongoing problem of students not being able to connect, not only to writing, but to what they're doing in college, period, mm-hmm. in a college classroom. So he says the disconnect always has a lot to do with the fact that we're ignoring the cultural experience those students have and how that connects to the language we're using in the classroom. Mm-hmm. Gerald Graff is also offering a historical cultural perspective on what students bring with them, only he's talking in terms of academic literary study rather than teaching writing. Mm-hmm. And Graff was saying that, or warning us against the promulgating or pushing this idea of a humanist myth, and the humanist myth being that academic studies, whether they're literary or not, are somehow unified by some narrative that is in itself complete, that we know exactly why we do everything that we do. And he's saying, no, 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 there's a problem. There are all kinds of ruptures between method and ideology. And those ruptures we cover over with that myth, okay? So when we go into a classroom, we're not really making it clear to students that there's a big argument between scholars and teachers, that there's an argument between researchers and the technical skills people. And mm-hmm. he says when we hide those conflicts, what we're doing is we're creating it's a detriment to teachers and students alike, because we're cutting off a chance for a conversation about our own cultural issues and how we connect to those issues. I hope that makes sense.
It does, because if I'm understanding what you're saying, is there's an opportunity there to have students understand the realities of what's going on in the discipline, that it's not, the answers aren't all there already, that there is a conversation that's going on and they can bring something yes. to the conversation.
Yes.
But if we pretend that that doesn't exist or we don't expose students to it, then we really are doing them a disservice.
Yes.
And they don't feel invited to participate in
right,
the
you're
conversation.
Stunting right. academic growth.
Right.
And the third book, of course, is Trenti Minha, who's book, Woman, Native, Other, has just had a great deal of impact on the way I think and the way I teach.
That's one I wrote down when you did your presentation, because I wasn't familiar with that one. Say a little bit about that.
Minha's book was, actually, she's a film director.
Okay.
But the book she published in 1989 focuses on disenfranchised writers, and she's mostly focused on African women writers mm-hmm. and Indian women writers and third world, quote unquote, writers in a European setting. Mm-hmm. Okay. Minha, what I found really useful in my own work is notice I'm not using terms like post-coloniality and feminism, mm-hmm. because I'm not thinking of her work so much from those theoretical stances. What I'm thinking of are the very real truths about what she calls the culturally dominant group, that's in general, okay, that defines itself vis-a-vis other groups it considers inferior to itself. And on the basis of that definition, this culturally dominant group seeks to, I guess I'm going to have to use the word, colonialize, mm-hmm. not bring in as a member, but control mm-hmm. Those groups it finds inferior. If you take that frame and you think about that in terms of pedagogy, if the professor is part of a culturally dominant group, thinking of students as inferior, it defines itself by way of the students having to be inferior, a thing that must be inducted rather than initiated into the culture as a member, then you're thinking about people who have a certain type of attitude. There is that word again. Towards the inferior as being socially, politically, and we can create other dimensions there, incapable of becoming a member. So they can only then learn by rote. They can be trained mm-hmm. to imitate their betters. But in the training itself is, again, that that necessity to take on self-reductionism, that's one, and two, to always be confronted with one's deficiencies, one's inadequacies, okay? When I thought about that, and I started using Minha as a map for what was going on in classrooms all around me. I had some professors. I won't say where. When I thought about that, I decided that that's not the kind of teacher I want to be. Mm-hmm. And I've tried to, and I guess I was 23 at the time, 23, 24. I began to develop ways of teaching that would combat that kind of behavior. And that's where, I guess, pedagogy, turning pedagogy inside out began mm-hmm. after reading those books. I had already started out believing that people had something in them mm-hmm. That literature could help guide. But now I could see that professionally I had to find professional ways to help people circumvent those.
Mm-hmm. Almost revolutionized your teaching,
absolutely.
Maybe.
Absolutely, yes.
So the third group of people that I think you've mentioned is students, and we started there, that, you know, this is a gift and that you've learned from students also. So what have they brought to the table that's shaped your teaching?
Students have brought what I would consider their curiosity, anticipation, ability to reflect, and to theorize. And what I mean by that is that they've shown me in their, and I'm saying it again, oral, written, and signed discourse, what it is they feel they need from professors and from the materials themselves, from themselves and from each other, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's a gift. They've given this to me, and I've used it as a way to help guide how I present what I have, what I've been trained to do, I use that as a way to give what I have to them. Specifically, what I've learned that students need, and I'm thinking of simple things, Judy, like letters, cards, mm-hmm. Where students have talked to me about transformation, about mm-hmm. Failure, mm-hmm. feeling victorious, whatever. Those are notes they mean for them to be sometimes celebrating me. You know, professor, I had a great time in your class. Here's a card. And I take it in the same spirit, but I also take it as a teaching tool. Because in that card or in that letter, the student is saying, here's who I am, and here's what I understand about a good teacher. You're available. You seem to really be interested in me and in mm-hmm. my interests. You are competent. You know, you understand what you're doing. You're confident. You walk in. It's you walk in with an authority, not based on this some phony idea of who you are, but you have confidence in what you're teaching, and I can see it, and I want to have that kind of confidence too. And you're humble. Mm. You talk to me about serving, and I'm as I'm speaking to you, I'm thinking about some of the language I've seen in those cards and letters. In their papers, I see students expressing needs concerning themselves, what it is they expect of themselves. And what I mean by that is, in the papers, I see students making moves that they never thought they could, rhetorical moves. When I teach, for instance, composition or literature or whatever, and I'm talking about writing in response to these things, I talk about making a move in terms of describing what it is you see. Using what I've taught you, secondary text, that I've taught in class to help you define or frame what you see. And then using other texts, perhaps, that I've taught to connect what you're reading to larger perspectives. What in terms of in relationship to larger perspectives, what does your reading actually imply about history, about this or about that? Students, the effort that they're making in their papers tell me that this is the kind of thing they want to do. I do want to say something that's communicable to an audience of thinkers and doers. And finally, I do write because I want to make sense of the world and my place in this world. I'll add as a cultural worker. So saying all of that, the gift from students has been the gift of themselves. They've told me who they are. Mm. And I work best when I know who my audience is.
Let me just end reading a little quote from you.
Okay.
She wrote as part of a bio. You said, when I was 7, I taught at my dining room table, on my porch, everything I was learning in school and from my own efforts to read and write to anyone who would listen to me. Receiving the 2008 Lindbeck Award gives me hope that someone has been and is still listening. And I think I said after I read that, your presentation was magical, and I think everyone was listening. I think you can be assured of that. So thank you very much for this inspiring conversation. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Olga.